Thank you, guys, and good evening to all of you. How are we tonight? Doing okay. Doing okay. We're getting there. And here's what I know, and we have been talking tonight about camp and this future award-winning music video rolled out tonight and stirred your soul at a powerful time. I know. I'll sign autographs after, and we'll do all of that. But here's what I'll say. It's not lost on me that maybe particularly at our 5 p.m. service, there are many of you who would find yourself in the category where summer camp is not an option for you. And here's why I say this. I want to say this from the very top of this sermon. And the reason I want to say this is because what can start to happen is you can start to get kind of like bummed out maybe on one hand, maybe frustrated on the other, maybe just kind of like, man, what's left for me? Why isn't this for me? And it can start to get really frustrating. But then here's just what I want to call you towards tonight. Two things. If you're here tonight and you're a senior, or maybe summer camp isn't, you just know like you're busy those days, so that's not going to work. I want two things from you tonight. The first is this. The first is that I want you to recognize that you have had an incredible run of camp in your 4 years of high school. Like for some of you, you have been to many different camps. Actually, if you're a senior, you went to all of the camps. You went to Hume Lake your freshman year. You went to Hume Lake your sophomore year. You went to Pine Summit your junior year. And you went to Murrieta in your senior year. And so you have had an amazing slew of camp experiences. And so if you're here tonight going, man, I'm just bummed out that I don't get to do it, my first request is this, that you would look around the room and go, there are people who haven't gotten to experience what I get to experience, and that you would encourage them. And then the second thing is this. If for some reason camp's not going to be your thing because you can't go or you won't go or whatever, here's the brilliant thing about the gospel. That the gospel doesn't need camp to get to you. Like, we are believers in camp. We put energy and time and money into camp. We believe camp is so important and so central and such an amazing thing, but it's not necessary for someone to come to know the freedom and the love and the joy that Jesus offers. And tonight, that's what we want to talk about. Tonight we're going to give you an opportunity, whether you're planning on coming to camp or not. We really, if you're eligible and you can, we just hope you do. Like with all of our heart, we hope you are a part of that this year. But either way, what we want to do is just open up the scriptures tonight and show you what the theme of camp is going to be, to show you what we're really talking about and why it's so important to us. And this scripture, this good news we're about to read about tonight is valid for you whether you're going to camp or not. It's valid for you whether you're going to be a part of it this summer or not. So here's how we're going to begin tonight. We're going to begin in Romans chapter 8. And Romans chapter 8, verse 14, it says this. It says, for those who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. Now, Romans 8 is this remarkable book of the Bible. And if you're here and you're kind of new to church, just checking things out, but maybe you own a Bible or you know how to get to a Bible, I would encourage you at some point to go read Romans chapter 8. It's this amazing chapter of the Bible that talks about God's love and His goodness toward us. And one of the key claims of the Bible is this, that when God saves someone, like when someone comes into a relationship with God, it makes them one of His children. And so that means something that is not so. And here's the thing that's not so. Some of us kind of come under the belief that every single person who has ever lived and every single person who's alive is a child of God. And that is not the case according to the Bible. I'll say that again. Not every human being is a child of God according to the Bible. According to the Bible, every human being is created in the image of God. Every human being is loved by God, is known by God, is valued by God, has dignity before God. But to become a child of God means you have been adopted into the family of God, where God is your father and Jesus is your big brother. You've been brought into the church, brought into the family of God that God creates, where He has created His family. And when you are adopted into that family, you become a child of God. So when Romans chapter 8 here says that for those who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God, it's not saying that everyone's led by the Spirit of God, and it's not saying that everyone in the world is a child of God. It's just that you, those of you who are here and you put your faith and trust in Jesus, you've believed in Him, you've received Him by faith, He is the Lord and Savior of your life, you are a child of God. And that is the truth about your life that cannot be taken away from you. This idea of being a child of God has obviously, for many obvious reasons, been so like heavy on my heart and just been such a thing I'm thinking about. Just because I love getting to say it, my wife and I are expecting a baby, which is awesome. And it's just so cool. And some of the other night, one of our volunteers, one of my friends was like, it feels like you're just looking for excuses to say that. And I was like, Yeah, that's exactly what I'm feeling. I am just looking for excuses to tell people that my wife and I are pregnant, and it's going to be the most loved child in the history of the world, and we love this baby already. But here's the crazy thing. Like, can I say something? This is nuts. Like, we don't even know if it's a guy or a girl yet. We've never, met this child. The child's never done anything. It's just there. It's never, done anything, right? It's not done anything good. It's not done anything bad. It's not done anything impressive. It's not accomplished anything. But I already love this human being because it's my kid. And I'm a dad. Dad, it's just so cute, but it's true. Like, here's the deal. So, if you were to say to me, well, what if he makes or she makes some bad choices someday and goes down a bad road and starts to live a lifestyle you disagree with? And my answer is easy. I'll still love it because it's my child. See, here's the crazy thing. Like, my child hasn't even been born yet, and I already love this child. Not because it's good, not because it's bad, not because this child has done anything or accomplished anything or even done anything to make me happy. I simply love this child because he's mine. And I wonder if there's someone in the room tonight who needs to hear that the God of the universe looks upon you as his child because you've received Jesus by faith. And he doesn't love you because of anything you've done. He doesn't love you because of what you've accomplished. He doesn't love you because you're a really good person who's really awesome at following Jesus. God loves you because you're his. He's your father. And you're his son. You're his daughter. What's true about this child that Jenny and I are expecting is so much more true about every one of you who calls yourself a follower of Jesus. That God does not love you because of what you have accomplished. He does not love you because of how awesome you are. He simply loves you because you're his. You belong to him. And here in Romans 8:14, it says, those who are led by the Spirit of God, they're called children of God. He goes on to say this, the Spirit that you have received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again, but rather, the Spirit you've received brought about your adoption of sonship, and in him we cry, Abba, Father. Meaning that the moment I become a Christian, I become a child of God, and I have this trust in God where he is my father. It says we cry, Abba, Father. This word Abba is this ancient word that kind of means daddy. Like, it's not just like, he's my father, and I respect him. He's my daddy, and I'm close to him, and he's for me, and he's with me, and he's on my side. Like, I was thinking a lot about this last weekend, actually. So we told my parents a while back that we were expecting, and so they came down to visit, and I was also preaching kind of over in the worship center this last weekend, and so my parents came down to check that out, and it was just awesome. Here's a picture of my parents. They're just great. This is Danny and I in the middle. Yeah, it's my parents. It's great. It's where I got all my coolness from. There's a lot of laughter. I don't get where that came from. Over here on the left, on your left, is my dad. His name's Vern Howard. Here's the thing. Vern is like the shortened part of his name. His name is actually Rollin Vernon Howard Jr., and so I just found myself really deeply grateful that I'm not Rollin Vernon Howard III. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but he goes by Vern for a reason. And then you got my mom, Nancy, who's just a spectacular woman of God. Raised four boys. Don't laugh at Nancy. She will whoop you. She raised four boys. I'm telling you, she's tough as nails. She's not taking anything from anyone. But here's my parents, and here's the crazy thing about my parents. And it's really not that crazy, but maybe in a world that we live in where there's so much brokenness, where there's so many families that are so messed up, man, I just sit here grateful all the time for the fact that my parents just straight up loved me. And here's what I mean. When I was doing good stuff, and when I was doing, things that they were proud of and things they wanted me to do, they loved me. And when I was doing things that they didn't want me to do and making decisions they didn't agree with and making mistakes that I made just because I was a teenager and I was an idiot and I was 16 and stupid, they loved me. Like, even later on in life, I was just making decisions sometimes where, I wouldn't do it that way, but they just chose to love me. Like, that never stopped. They never stopped loving me because I made decisions that they didn't agree with. And here's what I know. Like, I stand in front of this crowd knowing so many of your families, and I know that some of you don't have an experience with your parents like that. Like, some of your parents aren't awesome. Some of your parents aren't loving you no matter what you do. Some of you have really tough relationships with your parents, maybe even your dad, or maybe you don't even have a relationship with him. But here's how God designed it to be. Listen, Vernon and Nancy, they weren't perfect. They didn't do everything perfect. My childhood wasn't they never made a mistake. But here's what they did. They loved me in such a way that I never had fear that I wasn't going to be their kid. I never had fear that they were going to walk out on me. I never had fear that they were going to do something that would be against me and not for me. I never had fear that they were going to do something that was going to cost me my place in the family. See, when this text here talks about that we have this spirit that's been given to us, and it's a spirit of sonship so that we won't be afraid, that's what this text is talking about. It's talking about the fact that when I become a child of God, everything in me thinks, okay, but if I do some bad things, maybe God's going to toss me out of the family. And what that thing is, when Jesus makes me his son, it makes me unafraid because it makes me unafraid that anything I do will take God's love and affection away from me. That when I become a child of God, I am not afraid of losing my relationship with God because he is my father, I am his son, and nothing changes that. Nothing in the world can touch that. Well, when we go to camp this year, we're going to be looking at this idea of living free. What it's like to like live free and break free from these fears we have in our lives. And I'll just tell you this. I wonder if there's anyone in the room tonight, and your biggest fear, like your deepest fear in this world, is that you're going to make so many bad decisions and sin so many times that God's just going to be like, I'm done with you as my daughter. I'm done with you as my son. I want nothing more to do with you. I wonder if some of you have that fear that you've just messed up one too many times, that you've fallen short one too many times, and God wants nothing to do with you. And may you be set free tonight by this good news. That when you become a child of God, and he adopts you into his family, he adopts you now and forevermore. Because he loves you, and he's gracious to you, and he's kind to you, he's for you, he is with you, and he's on your side. God is your God, he's your father, and you are his child. And that creates in us a certain kind of like, I'm not afraid anymore. That's why, like in a really healthy family, there are things that you do inside the context of your family that you don't do in the rest of the world. Because you're just not afraid of being evaluated. Well, like, here's my guess. My guess is most of you have some sort of like clothing item that you only wear at home and you never wear in public, right? Like, somebody like, oh my gosh, who knows? No, I don't know. But here's what I'm saying. Like, some of you have something that you're like, yeah, I'll throw this on if I'm at home, and I'm certain that no one is ever going to knock on my door. Or maybe some of you have certain, like, inside jokes with your family that if you really objectively look at them, just aren't funny at all. But your family just cries every time you tell this. You guys are so great. Because you've had friends over and you told the joke, and they're like, I don't get it. So, here's what happens. We start to develop these things inside our families where we just feel safe. Where we're not worried about people evaluating us. Where we're not trying to impress people. And that's the kind of life Jesus wants for you. When we talk about being set free and living free, it's the type of life where you're not afraid of what everyone else thinks about you anymore. Where you're not trying to impress God and you're not trying to impress other people. You just get to live into the person God's called you to be. With his calling on your life and his purpose and his mission that he's given to you. That's the kind of fearlessness that the gospel offers us. It continues on this way. It says in verse 16, it says, the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. And so I don't want you to miss this. There is the truth of the gospel that the moment you receive Jesus, you become a child of God. And that is true. And you can know that true in your mind. But what this verse is almost referencing is something more than that. It's more than just knowing something's true. It's knowing it's true in your spirit. It's not just knowing it's true. It's experiencing it, feeling it, deep sense that this is true. My spirit and the spirit of God are confirming that I am a child of God and nothing can take that away from me. I don't know if you've ever experienced anything like that. I don't know if you've had a moment that was kind of a turning point in your life where you said, now I know. I don't just know facts about God. I don't just know the fact that I'm saved. I deeply, in the core of my spirit and who I am, feel like I am God's child. And I know that not just in my mind, but deep in my soul. For me, it happened my freshman year of high school. So I grew up in a Christian home and gave my life over to Jesus in middle school. But it was my freshman year of high school. I was on this camp. I was at summer camp. It was a house-building camp, and I was there for the whole week. And this week was really incredible. In fact, this is kind of like the trip journal from that week. And I hold on to this because these were such important times in my life. And I had this trip journal, and I'm working through it. And that whole week, we were actually talking about God being our Father, like our Abba. And what does that mean for us to trust God as our Father and be his child? And I just remember God was doing amazing things inside of me that week. In fact, one of the weeks, it was just so amazing. I snapped this picture, and I've kept it ever since. Back in the day where you had to, like, print out pictures. And I put it up on the screen here. That's me, the cool guy in blue. I really thought I was in a phase of my life where I thought, like, group pictures, the coolest thing to do was to point as if something was happening out in the distance. I thought it was really cool, and clearly I was. And so this was me, though. But here's the deal about this guy. He's 14 years old, and he's a freshman in high school. And back then, I'm trying to figure out, I know Jesus loves me, but I just feel like a failure all the time. I keep letting him down. I feel like I'm not a good enough Christian. And here's this 14-year-old me who starts to understand that God actually calls me his child. And hear me on this, eyes up here. God didn't just love me as though God loves everyone. God actually likes me. That was this crazy realization to me that the God of the universe didn't just sort of love me because that's what God's supposed to do for everyone, but he actually likes me, and he wants something to do with me, and he actually cares about me, and I'm not just this bother in his household. It's not that he's sick of me. He loves me and cherishes me as his child. That's what happened this week. I had the opportunity at camp to realize that God didn't just love me in sort of a theoretical way, but that he loved me intimately and deeply. He loved me enough to shed his own blood for me. I'll never let go of this. Like, this is one of the most precious things I own, because this was a week of my life where I said, okay, I'm going to set aside this week and go to summer camp. And I believe that the God of the universe is going to encounter me, and that it's going to change me. And he did, and it changed the trajectory of my life. What happened there was that the Spirit of God testified with my spirit that I was, in fact, a child of God. And I started to live free. I started to live in the freedom that Jesus offers us when we just say, Jesus, I'm with you, I'm for you, I'm going with you, I believe I'm your child, I don't have to impress you, I don't have to impress others. See, that's the kind of freedom that we want you to live in. That's the kind of life we want you to have, and that's the life that Jesus created for you. Well, you're not trying to impress everyone in your life. You're not trying to impress God. You're not trying to make everyone think you're awesome. You're not trying to, like, get before God in such a way that he thinks you're really awesome. You just understand that you are a child of the living God. He is your father. You are his child. And nothing can change that. And so maybe I could do it this way. Here's what happens in a lot of that. God has designed us. I believe God has designed Christians to live in such a way that we live free. Like, God has designed us that we would stand up and live free, that we would live a life where I'm not trying to impress you, and I'm not trying to impress God, and I'm not trying to impress anyone. I'm not trying to earn my way to God. I'm not trying to earn his favor. I'm just trying to live in such a way that I'm going to live free and live into being a son or daughter of the King. This is how God's designed us to live. But then here's my contention, and here's what we're going to spend some time at camp and in other things looking at. There are three things that keep us from this. I really believe there are three things that keep us from living the life God wants us to live. Three things that keep us from the freedom that Jesus wants for us. And it's three things that if you don't recognize these three things, if you don't deal with these three things, it will destroy you. Like, hear me clearly on this. You will never live the life that Jesus wants for you until you recognize and somehow deal with these three things in your life. I want to talk about those three things, and you'll see them up here. Those three things are sin, bondage, and fear. The three words the Bible talks about: sin, bondage, and fear. I want to maybe put it to you this way. Here's how I want to say this. We're going to have someone come on the stage right now who best represents sin in the entire world, and that's Mr. J.D. Lackey. If you're new to us and you're like, oh, what's this guy and why is he, like, representing sin? It's because J.D. is one of the best guys I know, one of the best followers of Jesus, and I love him to death. But we make fun of him because he's representing sin. And here's what sin is. Sin is the fact that we've fallen short of God's glory. Sin is the fact that we have fallen short of God's glory, that we have actually been guilty of violating the holiness of our God. And sin is this. Sin is the thing that keeps us from God. Sin is the thing that separates us from God. See, what God wants for us is a relationship with him, where forevermore we live in relationship with him, where we live free, where we don't feel guilt, where we don't just feel this, like, overwhelming guilt of I'm never going to be good enough for God. Sin is the thing that makes us guilty before God. And here's the deal.
You don't even have to be a Christian in this room to know exactly what this feels like. Maybe not this, but what sin feels like. Here's what I mean. I think some of you avoid meaningful relationships with people in your life because you know how sinful you actually are. Like, I think some of you avoid meaningful relationships in your life where you actually share your secrets and they share their secrets and you actually walk through life together because you think if someone found out how sinful you actually were, how many bad, wicked, awful things you've actually done, that they'd never want to be friends with you. They'd never actually love you. Some of you live in this fear of people actually finding out the wickedness in your own heart and so you never actually open up to anyone. Some of you live in this constant fear of God's judgment because you just think He hates you. And how could God hate me? And God hates me because of all my sin, and I've just fallen so short, and I've been such a mess, and the things I've done, if God even knew what I've done, and I guess He does because He's God, and so you just feel guilty. Like when I was in high school, I just played this constant ping pong between feeling like God loved me and God hated me. And on weeks where I went to church and read my Bible, on weeks where I was actually doing well with Jesus, I thought God really loved me in those weeks. And in those weeks where I fell into sin and I was kind of lazy and reading my Bible and praying and I skipped church and I just kind of fell away, I felt like God hated me. And that creates in you the type of life where you can't stand up and you can't live free because you're tied down by the guilt of your sin. That you feel so ashamed and guilty of your sin that you just feel like you can't live the life God wants you to live. That's what sin is. Sin is our guilt before God because of the ways we have sinned against Him, because of the ways we've rebelled against Him. And then the Bible has a second word. The Bible uses this word bondage. Maybe it's not a word you've used a lot, but the Bible actually uses this word bondage. And the idea is like a bond. It's like a rope. It's something that ties you down. When the Bible talks about bondage, what it means is this, that though some people we have dealt with our sin, like Jesus has forgiven our sin before God, here's the reality for most of you who call yourself Christians. I think most of you would recognize there are still areas of your life that you seem to be out of control. Where you're like, I'm a Christian. I shouldn't be doing this. And you seem to fall into this sin, like you really do love Jesus and you really do want to follow Him, but you keep doing that thing. Like I say this all the time, some of you have made a promise that you are never going to do that thing ever again. I'm never doing that again. And then you find yourself doing that. Like, I'm never going to go to the party again because when I went, it was just such a disaster, caused so much drama, caused so much heartache. I'm never going to go again. And this last weekend, that's where you found yourself. And you were like, I'm never going to hook up with that person ever again. It's never going to happen. I'm never going to let that happen. Because every time I do, and every time that happens, it causes pain in my life. Or every time I end up looking at pornography on the internet, every time I end up lying to my parents and being enraged with people and stirring up drama, some of you have made a promise that you'll never do that thing ever again. And here you are. It's like you don't even have control over it. It's like it controls you sometimes. It's like you make decisions in your life just so that you can feed that habit of that sin you have. But some of you live under this constant thing where you want to break free and you don't want to do that thing anymore, but you can't because you feel tied down, you feel overwhelmed, you feel like it's just not working. And so you really want to follow Jesus, but when you try, you can't. What does some of you know exactly what that's like? The Bible talks about sin, which is your guilt before God. It talks about bondage, which is the power that sin continues to seem to have over our lives. And then the Bible talks about a third thing that ties us down, and that third thing is fear. And it's fear. I was talking to a group earlier this week about these three different types of fear. For some of you, it's fear of God's judgment. Like, you've actually been forgiven by God, but you're still afraid of Him because you think you've sinned too many times. You've done too many bad things. And if, oh man, I stumbled again and I fell, and I guess God's going to hate me now and forevermore. Maybe He didn't forgive that sin, and so you're afraid of God's judgment. Maybe for some of you, it's what we've been talking about, that you're afraid of other people's evaluation of you. Like, it's crazy to me how many of you live your lives just trying to impress people who don't even really care about you. It's crazy to me how many of you live your lives trying to impress people at your school that you don't even know. And so the clothes you wear and the music you listen to and the words you say and the friends you hang out with all get shaped not by God's calling and His purpose in your life, but by what everyone else in your life thinks about you. It's an exhausting way to live. It's a really foolish way to live. Some of us live that way, and we just feel like it's the only way, and we want to break free of that, but we just feel stuck in trying to impress people, and then some of you just feel overwhelmed and afraid and anxious and nervous about the future. And it's like, what college am I going to go to? And how am I going to pay for that college? And what's going to happen with my family? And am I going to be healthy enough? Like, I'll tell you something. I'm genuinely not someone who's afraid of much in this world. But I'll tell you, since the moment we found out I was pregnant, like I'm not pregnant. She's pregnant. But since the moment I found out I was going to be a dad, I'll tell you what started happening. Like, immediately, there was this fear. Like, what if something happens to this baby? What if this baby doesn't make it? Like, oh my gosh, what if something happens to my wife? Like, what if something happens during that process and something happens to her? What if I'm not a good enough dad? Whoever said I was qualified to be a father? Like, what? Like, what if I'm not good enough? See, here's what I know, that you guys aren't walking through that, but a lot of you are walking through that same kind of fear, that same kind of overwhelming feeling of what if I'm not good enough, and what if I don't make it, and what if I don't make enough money, and what if I don't get into college, and what if I don't find the right girl, or what if I end up just lonely, or what if I end up broke, or what if I end up sick? What's going to happen to me? Here's what happens to us. Fear keeps us from living the way Jesus wants us to live. If some of you have someone you want to invite to summer camp, but you're so terrified of them saying no, that you're just gripped by fear. Some of you have someone in your family that you want to minister to or pray for or bless, but you're just so afraid of how they're going to react that you're just gripped by fear. Some of you have a purpose or a calling that God's given you. Like, you know God wants you to go into a particular thing. Maybe it's missions. Maybe it's ministry. Maybe it's that God wants you to go start a business or an organization that does something meaningful in the world. And you're so afraid of failure that you won't even try. And it keeps you back. And it keeps you from living free. See, I'll tell you something about what this is like. This is the life we live when we don't trust Jesus and what he's actually accomplished on our behalf. This is the life we can lead even as Christians, where Jesus has genuinely set us free, but we're just choosing to live in this. And here's the reality about this life. You are powerless to get out of this. You are utterly powerless to save yourself from this. You cannot do it. You are not strong enough. You are not smart enough. You are not good-looking enough. You are not talented enough to get yourself out of the things that keep you from living free, to release yourself from sin and bondage and fear. You can't do it on your own. And the tragedy is that some of you try. You think if you're just a good enough person and you get good enough grades or you have a good enough relationship or you have enough friends or you meet that girl or you meet that guy, it'll all just get better in your life and you will find yourself for the rest of your life living in such a way that you want to live for what Jesus wants to be, but sin and bondage and fear will be back. And the good news of the gospel is that only Jesus can free you from it. You can't. You cannot do it on your own. So we'll invite up right now, for the sake of this image, the person in this room who's most like Jesus, and that's my beautiful, wonderful life. It's true. I mean, it's just like it is. And here's the truth about Jesus, that when we come to Jesus in that first moment that we receive him as Lord and Savior, here's what I know. Some of you are in the room and you're not Christians. You're not even really sure what this is all about. In that moment that you come to Jesus and say, I want to receive you and turn my life over to you, in that moment, we're freed from the penalty of our sin, meaning Jesus frees us from the judgment of God because on the cross, Jesus absorbed that judgment for you. That you don't have to be guilty before God. God's not going to call you guilty, not because you're not guilty, but because Jesus took your place, that Jesus died for your sins. And that when you receive Jesus, the Holy Spirit of God comes inside of you and gives you the power. It starts to sanctify you, makes you more like Jesus, and it starts to free you from the grip of sin. And it doesn't happen in a day, and it doesn't happen in a week. It happens over the course of a lifetime. But it happens when we set our eyes on Jesus and start to look toward him and think about him and worship him and pray toward him and consider what he's done in our life. And that when that Holy Spirit of God comes inside of us, it creates in us a certain kind of courage. It says, I don't know what tomorrow holds, and I don't know what's going to happen next, and I don't know what's going to happen in my life and in this world, but here's what I'm certain of. Wherever I go, God goes before me, he goes with me. And I'm not afraid because the Spirit of God goes with me. I'm not in this thing alone. I've got God on my side. And if God is for me, who could possibly be against me? That's what creates courage in us, and that's what frees us from the chains of fear in our life. That's what frees us. But then here's the crazy thing. Like, right now, I've been totally free. Like, right now, I've been totally set free and totally let go of what's holding me back. But here's the crazy thing about a lot of Christians. A lot of Christians, and maybe you're the same way, have been completely and totally freed from the sin and the power of sin and bondage and your fear in Jesus. You've been totally set free from that. The gospel has liberated you. But let me tell you something about this chair I've been sitting in for the last 10 minutes. It's mighty comfy. It's nice. It's got a good rock to it. I'm pretty comfortable. If I were to get up, I'd have to stand, and standing's difficult. And I don't like to do that. I'd rather just kind of sit right here in this chair, not because it's the best. It's really not good in a sermon to sit the whole time. I know it's not the best thing for me to do, but if I were to stand, I'd actually have to get up, and that would be difficult, and it might actually take something out of me. And so here's what a lot of Christians do. Like, Jesus has totally freed you, but you're just sort of cool chilling in the chair. Like, some of you, Jesus has totally freed you from sin and the power of sin in your life and the fear that grips you, but for whatever reason, you become comfortable living that way, and so you do. If I'm telling you what summer camp is about this year, here's what summer camp is. Here's our theme. Here's what we're driving at. Not just for summer camp, but for the rest of your life. What we want you to do is to say that Jesus has freed me and I'm done. Like, I'm done with it. Like, I'm done with living that way. I don't want to live that way anymore. And I'm not going to sit down here. I'm not going to let sin own my life. I'm not just going to walk around guilty before God because I believe He's forgiven me. Not because I don't take sin seriously, but because I take Jesus seriously when He says I'm forgiven. I'm not going to sit here anymore and let sin own my life. And that addiction is going to not own my life anymore. I'm not going to be that person who's always embarrassed to share in small group because I know I'm so guilty. I'm just going to be done with that. I'm going to repent of my sin. I'm going to stand up and I'm going to live free. And I'm not going to live in fear anymore. I'm not going to be the girl who's anxious about everything anymore. I'm not going to be the guy who's always overwhelmed with things in my life. I'm going to stand up and I'm going to live free. And that's the invitation we'll be talking about at camp, but it's the invitation that's for all of your lives. That you would stand up and live free. That you wouldn't live afraid of everything anymore. That you wouldn't live afraid of God's judgment or afraid of what people think about you. That you would live a life of courage. That's what it means to be set free. To be set free of the fear of God's judgment and the fear of everything in this world. That you would stand up and that you would live free. That's our invitation for you tonight. It's our invitation for you at camp. That you would experience what it means to live free. That you would experience what it means to have the gospel liberate you from sin and bondage and fear. This is going to happen. Our band's going to come up, and we're going to close by singing a song that will kind of be our theme song for camp, but also a song we're just going to start singing here because we think it's so important. And it's a song, and maybe some of you have heard of it. It's called No Longer Slave. And who's got No Longer Slave? Here's the chorus of it. It says, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. It's so simple. It says, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. And this is the invitation for you tonight. The invitation for you tonight is to say, I don't want to live in fear anymore. I don't want to live in fear. I don't want to live in bondage. I don't want to live in sin. I don't want to live in that anymore. I want to live as a child of God who is totally unafraid, who feels totally safe in God's family, who recognizes that I am His son, I am His daughter, and nothing in this universe can pluck me out of His hand. That is the kind of courage I want for your life, where you say, whatever happens to me, I have Jesus, I'm Him His family, and that's enough for me. In just a moment, we'll stand and sing that I'm no longer afraid of you, that I'm a child of God. That's our invitation for you. It's our invitation for camp. And it's what we want you to experience now and for the rest of your life. Let's pray. And Jesus Christ, I come before you tonight recognizing that you have set us free. That through your cross and resurrection and through your gift of faith to us, we can live a life where we're not afraid anymore, we're not overwhelmed anymore, we're not stuck in sin anymore. And God, I pray for anyone in this room who's trying to figure out what that means. I pray for the person who's here who feels like they stumbled into too much sin and they've lost their salvation. I pray that that person would be sure not in their faithfulness, but in yours. I pray for the person who's battling an addiction and battling some sin in their lives. God, I pray you would give them strength through your Holy Spirit to overcome. And I pray for the person who's afraid, who's terrified of the future, who's anxious and nervous about what's next. God, that you would give them the confidence and the faith, even the courage, to know that you go with them wherever you go. God, we are no longer slaves to fear. We are children of you. We are a child of God. May we live with courage. May we live free. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone says, amen.